Hello, my dear friends. Welcome back to the channel. And this is your friend, Dr. Suresh Shenvi. When we read the various steps in the fundamentals of cavity preparation, the most confusing part in all those steps is the secondary retention and resistance features. That's mostly because we don't practice much of those features when you are in undergraduate days. So today I am covering all the remaining steps of fundamentals of cavity preparation in this last video of our series of fundamentals of tooth preparation. If you have not seen the earlier videos, the links will be in the description. The seventh step of fundamentals of tooth preparation explains secondary retention and resistance form. Now, this is very peculiar because when you talk about the initial steps of cavity preparation, we are explained primary resistance and retention form in a separate way. That's because most of the time the features which are given in secondary retention in turn give the resistance form too. That also happens with the primary resistance and retention features, but that's more common with the secondary retention and resistance features. The secondary resistance and retention features are achieved in two ways. One, you can alter the cavity preparation. For example, you can make a retention groove that requires cutting of the tooth. The second step is by doing some treatment to the preparation. For example, if you are doing a bonding, you are not actually altering the tooth structure by cutting it. You are just giving a surface treatment to the preparation. The first feature to obtain secondary resistance and retention form, and this is very commonly asked, and that is named as retention lock and retention groove. Please remember that when you use this feature for amalgam, it is called as retention lock, and when you use it for the cast restoration, we call it as retention groove. The most important thing when you are giving this retention feature is this should be always given in dentin and not in the enamel. You can give it vertically if it is meant for class 2 restoration. You can also give it horizontally if it is meant for the class 3 or class 5 restoration. Retention grooves are obtained by using 169L burr, and they are generally given in the axio-buccal and axio-lingual line angle when you are doing a class 2 restoration. If you are given a dowtail or if you are doing a MOD restoration, you really don't require to give the retention groove or retention lock, since the dowtail and the other part of the box would be sufficient to obtain good amount of resistance and retention. The second feature to obtain secondary resistance and retention form is called as reverse bevel, and this is only given for amalgam. This is exactly like a bevel which you can give at any margin, but this is given at the junction where you have the axial wall and the gingival seat meeting. And if you can see this diagram, this basically prevents the proximal movement of the restoration because it acts like a lock to prevent the movement. Third important feature is called as internal box, and this is only given for the cast restoration. Now, we all know that a box has a nice shape. If you can look at it in a dental perspective, you see that there is point angle and line angle, but they are neatly aligned. So that's exactly how you see the internal box even into the cavity preparation. This is basically given at a periphery, and especially where you have good amount of dentin, and the depth would be somewhere around 2 mm all over. And this is considered to be one of the most efficient secondary retention and resistance form for cast restoration as per the textbook. Then you have slot. If you look at this slot and the retention box, both look very similar, but the slot will not have the prominent line angles and point angles. So it is like more of a rounded margin than when compared to the internal box. Then comes the retention cove, which is given for amalgam restoration and not for the cast restoration. This is basic small retentive grooves into the floor or wall of the restoration into the dentin. The dimension would be somewhere around 1 mm of depth and 1 mm of height. And the next feature is the pins used for restoration. You can use pins for the direct restoration, and you can also use it with the cast restoration, in that situation it is called as indirect. Pinch should be only used when you are doing a large restoration. For example, you are doing a complex restoration where you don't want to put a cast restoration, and in that situation you can use multiple pins to increase the resistance and retention of the amalgam restoration. But what's the problem? That various studies have found that even though the retention of the restoration is increased by using pin, but the strength of the tooth is reduced. That's because when you put the pin into the dentin with lot of friction, that generates a lot of force over the tooth and it may damage the tooth structure and eventually lead to fracture. And if you are drilling hole for the pins, you may end up exposing the pulp too. There is one very important point when you talk about increasing retention of the restoration by using pin is when you are placing multiple pins, you should always place it non-parallel to each other. So this has found to increase the retention of the restoration. But the problem is the junction between the amalgam and the pin is weaker and they may simply fracture at this position. If you want to overcome the disadvantages of pin, then you can give another retentive feature called as amalgam pin, which basically evolved from a retentive feature named as amalgam inserts, and that had a shape dimension of 1.4 millimeter and that was modified by Shavel. And as we learned earlier that the junction between the pin and the amalgam is weak, so why not make a pin which is made up of amalgam? And that's exactly what the amalgam pin does, that you create the retentive feature which has dimension of 1 to 2 millimeter in depth and 0.5 to 1 millimeter in width, and in this small retentive feature the restoration will flow, and since that forms like a post and it is in continuation with the restoration, there is no other interface for a chance of fracture. This also means that you no longer have to create unnecessary forces into the dentin. The next feature is preparation extension. Suppose you are doing class 2 restoration and you are only involving the lingual groove. If you want more retention, then you extend your cavity preparation into the buccal groove 2, or you go more towards the distal area. Apart from all this, there are other two secondary retention and resistance form, that is skirts and collars, which are meant for cast restoration. I am planning to make a video on principles of cast restoration very soon, and I will try to discuss in those videos in a much simpler way. Till now, we covered the various mechanical alterations of tooth structure in order to improve the retention. And now we'll be talking about the various modes of surface treatment which you can use to improve the retention. These basically are a part of doing a restoration than the cavity preparation, but the books do include these things into the secondary retention and resistance form. And the most important aspect in this is the use of bonding or cements. Cements, we do know that they tend to increase the retention of the restoration if it is a cast restoration, and bonding also has a very big role. But when it comes to amalgam bonding agents, the book clearly says that they don't recommend the bonded amalgams. However, various studies clearly prove that when you use the micromechanical bonding of the composites, they also increase the retention and resistance of the tooth. Coming to the next major step of fundamentals of tooth preparation, that is step 8, which covers external wall finishing. Basically, this tells you three important points. One is that you should have a smooth flow of the outline. You don't want to have a sudden acute angle because that will increase the chance of force over the restoration and the tooth. And the second thing is you should have surfaces with keeping in mind which material you are using for the restoration. For example, for composite, you would like to have rough surface by using the diamond points, so that increases the bonding of the composite to the tooth. The next important point at this step is whether to give bevel or no. And I'm sure your teacher will always ask you, where do you give bevel in the amalgam restoration? Bevels in amalgam restoration are not given except into the gingival cavus surface margin. That is where the gingival seat meets with the external wall. And that is because of the change in the direction of enamel rods. And we'll try to learn about it more into the class 2 cavity preparation video, which I will try to release very soon. Bevel for composite, yes, you can give bevel for composite, but not on occlusal surface, and you can give it in any other area. Now, what is the advantage of giving a bevel for composite? One thing would be that you can incorporate minor defects very easily when you give a bevel. Second, since you are increasing the surface area, you are exposing more of enamel rods, and hence bonding of the composite to the enamel would definitely improve. And the third important point is, if you are doing a bevel in an anterior teeth, you can get a very nice shade. Generally, when the students, when they are learning in initial days, you can see a demarcation between the composite and the tooth margin. That can be prevented by giving a nice bevel. What about the bevel over the root surface? If you are planning to do amalgam restoration or composite too, and if your cavity extends on the root surface, you are not supposed to give any bevel over the root surface, because in root surface we have cementum, we don't have enamel rod, and that will not give you any specific advantage. And it is better to have the butt joint at this junction, both for composite and the amalgam restoration. What about cast restorations? Cast restorations, you need to have bevel all over, and that we'll discuss as mentioned into the principles of cast restoration video, which we'll try to release soon. The last step of fundamentals of tooth preparation, that is step 9, is debridement and inspection. Although many students don't read this chapter, but trust me, this is very important. And what it basically means, you remove all these debris which are left, you may use a hand instrument and you may use a coolant to remove the debris, but you should not over dry the tooth, because the research has found that when you blow a lot of dry air over the dentin, it can lead to the movement of the fluid into the dentinal tubule, increasing the chances of pain to the patient, and even desiccate the tooth and lead to aspiration of odontoblast into the dentinal tubules, which will lead to discomfort once you are done with the restoration. So that completes the series of fundamentals of tooth preparation, and I hope that it was helpful to you. If you have any suggestions or questions, please feel free to write into the comment section, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. I hope to see you once again on this channel with one more new video very soon.